Thank you. The comment of the cardiologist in the room was the heart come first. I disagree. As a matter of fact, kidneys are so important that we have two, while heart is only a stupid electrical pump, and we have only one. Tremendous impact on patients hospitalized for heart failure when kidney functions start to worsen, and in most cases, mortality, and length of stay, and percent of patients that stay in the hospital for more than 10 days increase dramatically. And there is a prediction of mortality both at 30 days, at 6 months, and inside the hospital, whether or not you increase the little amount of trivial number deciliter of creatinine. Of course, when renal function starts to decline, if you have presence of for example, congestion, and this is documented by biomarkers of heart failure, you get a progressive decline in cumulative survival at this stage. So the cardiorenal interactions have been discussed for many years, but basically it's a vicious circle. These are two important organs beside it. And it doesn't really matter whether the first is the heart or the kidney, but the primary insults start a vicious circle through physiological derangements that lead to progressive deterioration of function in the other organ. Now, we have discussed this in the past, and that's why we have called this cardiorenal or renocardiac syndromes, leading to the concept that this is a poorly defined situation, acute or chronic, and it is also bidirectional, starting with the kidney or with the heart. In this case, we have the group of cardiologists and nephrologists gathered together in Venice on the consensus conference of the cardiorenal syndrome. And I would like to show you that when we submitted this paper, it was considered kind of a revolution because it described very well for the first time the different type of interaction. And this was the most accessed paper in the So our definition described five different types, and the cardiorenal axis is depending on whether there is an acute or chronic derangement, whether it is first cardiorenal or renocardial, but there is also a type 5 system that is secondary to other systemic disorders, including diabetes and other conditions. I'd like mostly to point out conditions in which the initial heart disease or procedures applied to the heart may induce damage or dysfunction in the kidney through different mechanisms that have been listed from hemodynamics to iatrogenic down to hormonal and finally to immune-mediated damage. On the other hand, we know that when we have a KI, there is a influence on possible acute heart dysfunction. Specifically, it has been shown that myocardial contractility is decreased in these patients because of circulating mediators that impair the capacity of the myocyte to be contracted. So let's start with the first mechanism called hemodynamic, that is basically a combination of two mechanisms. One is hypoperfusion, the other is congestion. First of all, you have to diagnose cost, what they call low cardiac output state. But remember, not all patients have a low cardiac output state. Some of these patients have simple chronic congestion, what today is defined broadly as diastolic dysfunction, and these patients have a specific kind of interaction with the compensatory mechanisms. In one side, when you have arterial underfilling due to low cardiac output, you have a sympathetic response and activation of renin-angiotensin system. On the other, when you have venous congestion, you have natriuretic peptides and other endothelial relaxing factors that are, however, not efficacious in this case as a compensatory mechanism. Both these conditions lead to decreased perfusion pressure in the kidney, leading to potential AKI functional in nature at the beginning, but then developing polyclonal damage. And on a more susceptible kidney, as you can find here in the upper part, probably the possibility to develop AKI is even increased. So there's a combined effect of worsening renal function and congestion that has been studied in different conditions. In this case, is the endpoint death at 1 year or heart failure readmission. Now, interestingly enough, we have discussed already this thing. There is a U-shaped curve that describes the complication whether the patient has a liberal intake and positive fluid balance or diuretic ultrafiltration filtration and volume depletion. But if you have a diseased heart, the window of opportunity for optimal management is more narrow. So you can actually derange the system while what you seek is optimal fluid status. It's not the case that Apke a few years ago in Venice somehow discussed the possibility to slightly modify the new classification into some subclasses where, in fact, you may have the possibility or not that intervention with ultrafiltration or intervention with specific therapy may reverse the status of that patient. So, if the patient is susceptible or not to improve based on this therapy. Iatrogenic complication in the cardiorenal axis includes several different drugs, metformin, chemotherapy, inside, contrast media, ACE inhibitor, ARBs, ARNs, and also diuretics. And we know very well that diuretics correspond to a therapy that is frequently done in this patient, especially in the very first days of admission, and believe it or not, these are exactly the days in which creatinine tends to increase, sometimes because diuretic therapy is done improperly or not. We have seen typically patients arriving with high BNP and minimal diuresis, increasing diuresis when treated with diuretics. The wet component of BNP decreases progressively, and you start to abandon the signs and symptoms of congestion, however, creatinine. Now, what we suggest today is to monitor this patient with biomarkers and possibly to get a warning as an injury may be induced so that you can stop diuretics, you can monitor the patient for different parameters and potentially, as in this case, have no increase in serum creatinine. Narrow hormonal interaction in this cardiorenal axis is clearly defined when the different systems are activated, including vasopressin, that in normal condition display a capability to increase water and sodium excretion. In the failing heart, there is an non-osmotic AVP release which activates V2 receptors that end up activating the tubular cells and the aquaporins at the luminal interface. Increasing permeability to transport to water and decreasing, therefore, water excretion and sodium excretion, increasing, however, the content of transport for urea reabsorption. That's why several diseases have high urea because of hemodilution over hydration. There is efferent and afferent possibility of the narrow hormonal transmission and the sympathetic nervous system to interact between the brain and the kidney. And it has been hypothesized that urinary denervation may bring to a break into this vicious circle. However, this has never really been demonstrated. What about toxins? Well, including comorbidities and aging of the kidney, the most frequent example of a toxic AKI induced in heart patients is when the cath lab is performed and they receive high dose of contrast media into the very delicate structure of tubular cells that you can well see described here with adhesion molecules and so on. When iodinated contrast media molecules are attached to the cells, you have an easy derangement. structure of the cells. And there are several different factors that include inadequate time for prophylaxis and hemodynamic instability, joined with high complex volumes and biological factors, including all the mechanisms that we have described, that may enhance the level of damage at the kidney. At this point, we have even slapping of cells that are viable originally, and the primary injury induced a condition of toxic acute tubular necrosis, which is also enhanced by the presence of vasoconstriction, circulation of free radicals. And today we know that the best possibility to limit this is to use non-ionic dimeric is of smaller contrast media, but the best approach is certainly to avoid unnecessary imaging techniques and to avoid large amount of these substances. In any case, this dimeric non-ionic isosmolic contrast media seems to provide much less vasoconstriction compared to what is normally seen in the contrast media. One interesting study that we have published recently was the impact of hemodilution and the protective effect of fluid infusion in this patient. Now, it's not the same if you give 2 liters of fluid to a dehydrated person or to an overhydrated person. So what we studied was bioimpedance in this patient, and we found that actually the presence of contrast-induced AKI was definitely lower in who received effective hemodilution by infusion and not simply a fixed dose of fluid. One more thing, inflammation and immunomediated damage. You can see easy here the monocyte activation and endothelial activation may contribute to a kind of vicious circle to activation of cascades and apoptosis in cells, but also cytokine secretion and circulating neurons. Now, we know that inflammation is something that goes well beyond the initial hemodynamic phase and contributes to maintenance of the damage at the kidney level. We published recently the mechanism that is potentially involved in neurological mediated damage, and I would like to acknowledge the contribution of our biologist to this study. We simply took a failure patient, plasma, and we incubated with monocyte cell. We studied apoptosis, but we also took the supernatant and we incubated with renal tubular cells. We studied the level of cytokines and the level of apoptosis in renal tubular cells. What we discovered was that only patients who developed cardiorenal syndrome type 1 at 72 and 96 hours had a very high level of apoptosis induced by plasma. Which is documented by higher level of IL-6 and TNF in plasma. But also, we found that the supernatant is inducing high level of apoptosis in renal tubular cells only from those patients who have developed the cardiorenal syndrome type 1, showing that there is a neural mechanism that probably is involved in the damage of the renal tubular cells in long term. So inflammation is probably an important element in perpetuating the mechanism of damage that includes several immune system cells in deficiency. So, now, risk factors are several, and they all contribute to increase the possibility to develop cardiorenal syndrome. But if you have more than one of these risk factors, actually, the risk to develop a cardiorenal syndrome is progressively increased. There are also several others, including diabetes, hypertension, cachexia, obesity, and cardiometabolic syndrome, and also, in case of uremia and urine solid retention, the possibility of misuse of the iron, and of course, anemia, which increases cardiovascular work and stress at the level of myocardium. And at any point of the history of this kidney, acute damage may occur, whether it is acute on chronic or it is acute de novo syndrome. As we discussed this morning, there is a high possibility that there might be no complete recovery, and in case of partial recovery, this increases susceptibility to further insults at this kidney. And the heart failure patient, of course, is susceptible to develop multiple hits to the kidney due to the original condition. This may lead to progressive scarring in the kidney with collagen deposition, and leading to the possibility to increase significantly the desire patient to develop a CKD or even end stage. This is due to damage progressively to the kidney that initially may be subclinical in nature, but evolves into a more evident damage when more than 50% of the nephromass is compromised. However, as you can see here, creatinine only starts to increase very late in the history when several nephrons have been affected. We have developed this concept of the renal stress test, and this is the nomogram that we use to test the capacity to increase based on GFR, based on oral protein load. But what describes this better is this blue line that describes very well the increase in susceptibility in the kidney when almost 50% of the nephrons are actually lost. At this point, even a small intensity in exposure may lead to the clinical domain syndrome. In this case, we have structural biomarkers, and we may have biomarker functional injury later on. But remember, biomarkers allow you to detect this damage much earlier compared to the clinical clock given by creatinine and GFR. And patients who have developed positive biomarkers, even though creatinine is negative, develop a kind of endpoints in terms of dialysis and mortality which are close to patients who have frank AKI. So, new damage criteria included in the KDIGO recommendation for diagnostic criteria. And this has led, as I showed this morning, to a new semantics of AKI, where subclinical AKI is detected by molecular signature, especially now that we are using cell cycle arrest biomarkers. As I told you this morning, we have the possibility to diagnose AKI by creatinine increase and non-creatinine increase, as we do for SD elevation or non-SD elevation myocardial infarction. So diagnosis and biomarkers today to diagnose what we call subclinical AKI. In conclusion, I think that heart and kidney interactions are bidirectional, they are time dependent, they are mediated by several pathophysiological mechanisms, physical, chemical, and biological. And pre existing concomitant pathological conditions represent important risk factors for developing cardiac syndrome. We have several aspects: innate immunity, adaptive immunity, inflammation, cell death, oxidant stress, epigenetic, small non-coding RNA, and extracellular vesicles that may be implicated in the bidirectional level of damage that these two organs may face in conditions of arterial function of one or the other of the two systems. We need to recognize patient subsets. We need to consider biomarkers for early identification and understand precipitating factors, medication, procedure, and other. And possibly explore new cardiovascular syndrome prevention and organ protection based on pathophysiological measures. With this, I'd like to thank all the people in our institute and thank you very much for your attention.